three wrong stories, one right story.
This is about the intimate relationship between Australia and New Zealand, and I'm afraid Mr. McLaughlin is claiming that we're not quite as close to the sheep in New Zealand and the men and women as we should be. Would you like to expand?
Well, and New Zealand has a very feeble little navy.
Well, they
have one navy.
Our navy may not seem much to you.
You don't have to answer the question if you don't want it. People do have other arrangements to make tonight. They do have births to go to. They've got sheep to shoot. And if you're just going to hang around here tonight and clog up the circumstances, you'd be better off letting us have a go at the question.
May be insubstantial, but it looks good to the New Zealanders, and they to be part of it.
They want to be part of it, and our defence minister says, forget it. If you don't spend more money and get more ships, you can't play with
them. Shut up, 5 points. The New Zealand defence minister says his country's navy is so small, it might make sense to form a joint force with Australia. Minister of Defence Max Bradford said that while their ships aren't quite as modern as ours, New Zealand's Navy can still do some things Australia's can't. Like what? Fit in a shed? If we did join forces, the two countries would need to coordinate foreign policy. We'd have to accommodate their anti-nuclear stance, and they'd have to learn how to kiss Suharto's bottom. The good news is a lot of our sailors are looking forward to working with the Kiwis. It might not be a big navy, but there's still a lot of stuff worth stealing. MRMSHG, watching?
Yes, keenly. Boris Boom Boom Yeltsin.
Yes.
Bunch of blokes who were down at the CES the day after.
Right.
And that's Minister for Nodding.
Well, this is about Yeltsin sacking the government, waking up one morning and thinking, I'll sack them, all of them, out.
with that very same movement.
You're gone. Get out!
For the absolutely quaint reason that they weren't improving the life of ordinary people.
Well,
there's nothing quaint about that. That was a meeting of Alcoholics Anonymous in Russia. The first meeting was where... Boris came in and said, my name's Boris Yeltsin and I've got a story to tell. And then he sat down and proceeded to bore the pants off everybody else until they left. Then the miracle cure was effected, and then he decided to get a bit uppity and sack the government because he came too briefly from an alcoholic stupor and thought it was a bloody good idea.
Yeah.
You know
what it's like, Mikey? 5 o'clock in the morning in the underpants on the outside of the trousers. You do get ideas, don't you, pal?
Now we see why Johnny Howard is so worried about presidents.
Well, yes.
I mean, if they're going to sack people for not improving the life of ordinary people, he's got big worries.
That's your answer, Paul.
You have got it, 5 points. Thank Congratulate you. Them, please.
She's as good as she's good.
Could I keep the gasket to keep the hands above the table, Mike?
Yes, please.
I don't want to be unseemly. I mean, the ABC's been beset by unseemly problems recently,
yes,
and I want a nice, family, tasteful show tonight.
Of course.
Right. Yes.
You can put the hand in the pocket, I understand that, and especially when you stand up, because that could scare the kiddies at home.
And back to Boris Yeltsin. Yes, the Russian president, Boris Yeltsin, stunned the world this week when he sacked his entire cabinet. Boris, of course, denies that his decision-making is addled. He says he gave up drinking 6 months ago, so he's been sober for nearly 3 months now. Yeltsin just wants the people around him to have special skills, a knowledge of external heart massage, for example. Boris got rid of the cabinet for many reasons, but mostly because he heard they called him Boris Yeltsin behind his back. When he was told he was Boris Yeltsin, he got very depressed. Strange but true clues, if you'd be so kind. Macrossan, Hall and Byrne, you have a severed limb.
I'm sorry, it's distasteful.
A studded dog collar?
Dog collar.
Until you see. What?
And a suitcase.
It's clearly a New South Wales police story.
It's a picnic set.
And Robin, Scott and Nelson were given brain damage. An insurance policy.
It's a good read, that.
Are you an alcoholic? Have you been to Russia?
And this.
Yes, for he's a jolly good fellow, for he's a jolly good fellow, for he's a jolly good fellow, and so say all of us, including Boris Yeltsin.
To get us going in round two, Good News Roulette. Rich, we'll show you three headlines from a fine Australian publication called New Weekly.
Oh, yeah?
All you have to do is tell us which one actually appeared in the magazine.
Right, then.
And that sound means that you're playing for a special mystery prize. In fact, this week, the Good News Week CD. Not a lot of mystery there either. Okay. Your headlines are Lose Fat with Your Cat.
Yes.
Pets for the 21st Century, Empty Fish Tanks. And Dog Food Cured My Arthritis. Which one made it to New Weekly?
Well, Lose Fat with Your Cat, that would have, that'd be like a Dr. Seuss exercise book right there. That would be a headline. Pets for the 21st Century, Empty Fish Tanks is just very Kafkaesque and pathetic. Sad. I think it would be Dog Food Cured My Arthritis, because I believe that a lot of people do enjoy dog treats. And
also, interestingly, it sums up our own federal government's aged care policy.
Yes.
Country who are being critical of the current federal government in relation to health and the elderly, but how wrong they are. By simply making them so poor they have to eat dog food, they're actually curing their arthritis.
I've tried this cure, and I can give people two tips. Firstly, let the dog have a go at the dog food first. That does bring the arthritis to a boil. Or if you are desperately in trouble, eat the dog once he's eaten the dog food. This is a very fine CD. In my mind, there's a tribute to Die record, which has got Elton and Billy and all those people on it, and I can't get the struck match between that and this. That's how much I value this CD. And I don't know Paul McDermott at all. I've never met Paul McDermott until tonight. Paul McDermott, as far as I'm concerned, is a goose. In my mind, he's an absolute idiot to himself. He needs to go into a room of mirrors and have a bloody good hard look at himself. This CD, on the other hand, is wonderful.
HG, for your kindness.
Can I have 5 points for that, you
No,
biker.
You can't. No, not even your goat.
What do you have to do to get a point round here?
The only thing you'd have to do to get any points tonight is just shut up a bit. Okay. Do you want to have another crew? We're very kind to our overseas guests. We normally
He has suggested that because you're a guest from overseas, it might not be three.
It might not be correct? Three. I'm going to give you another.
No, I think it is three.
Well, hang on. Okay.
Let's just have a look and see if Rich Hall is right.
Oh! It's a diet.
What you wouldn't realise that in Australia, fat has two meanings as well.
And maybe it's time to put those little kitties to bed. Cats are replacing barbells in the latest exercise craze to hit America, cat flexing. Yes, lose fat with your cat by stripping away that weighty burden, self-respect.
Doesn't seem to have worked for her.
Workouts include cat crunches, cat twists, and the strenuous cat lift. All you need is enough room to swing a cat. One of the more controversial exercises is the catapult, which involves a small feline and a large rubber band.
Can I just advise blokes who might be watching that the cat attached to the bed flute extends it enormously over a period of time? The great thing is the cat comes with an attachable system of four hooks on every paw. Don't be afraid to just wander around all day with a cat strapped onto the night tools and impress friends at the end of a month or two with how it's going downstairs.
Alfred, your headlines tonight from the Weekly World News. Are you ready?
Yes.
Oh, and your special mystery prize is the limited edition Mikey Robbins mask.
Have a go.
Yeah, amaze your friends. Thrill your family. Scare the children.
It does something for you, Margaret.
Okay, Margaret, your headlines are New Hope for Fat People, Throat Stapling. New Hope for the Ugly, Designer Headbags. Or the third one, New Hope for Bald Men, Hair Transplants from Corpses.
Of course,
it's clearly not the first one, as that would end many promising political careers.
And I think it's, I mean, fat,
like that of Chopper Vanstone.
Yes.
I thought so. I thought thought it was rather tasteless to bring her on, you know? I mean, how would you feel if you were a university?
Watching
her there.
Randy as hell. Actually, I know a lot of fat people. I'm a fat person, you know. We develop a taste for staples. I mean, you know.
No, I don't think it could be the first one. New hope for the ugly designer headbags. It must be the last one.
Okay, let's just see if Scott of Tasmania is right.
Yes!
An American surgeon has allegedly performed the world's first scalp transplant from a hairy human corpse to a live bald patient. Deceased hair? Yeah, yeah. This new procedure will call for a new range of shampoos which care for dry, normal, oily, or deceased hair. Legally, a bald man will only be able to receive hair from a registered hair donor, but if he's desperate enough, he'll be able to pick up hair on the black market, or the blonde market, or the ginger market, if that's what he's after. To finish off now, bites. This is just for you, Jennifer.
I am now on my second suit.
He's in Ghana. He's in Ghana. He was mobbed. It was very hot. He was mobbed by a group of wildly excited Ghanaians.
Must have been strange to him having people press themselves against him for a change.
It could be that his suit got crushed.
It could be a simple suit check.
He was in a country doing his job, and what he did, as well as being crushed, he wore a bit like this actually. He was given one of these outfits where you wrap around. Remember, like the guys who wear Trogum?
It was
a shawl and.
And I think Hillary got a sort of a little lap-lappy thing
there
as well. Oh, yes.
Let's talk about the fashion some other time, ladies.
I think maybe that was his second suit.
If you were Hillary, would you be travelling with Bill or not at this stage?
I'm going to give you 3 points. Let's hear it. Bill Clinton is facing even more sexual harassment allegations after 20,000 African women rubbed up against him in a provocative manner in Ghana this week. There he is, shouting, "Back up, he's about to blow!" What? Bill admitted reluctantly that yes, the mob was aroused, but denied that every woman there should be given a job at the White House. But Hillary was never concerned for her husband's life, since she had him Teflon-coated. Overly affectionate people just slide right off. HG, your bite now from this well-spoken man.
We remain eternally vigilant. That's the sensible thing to do, but there's no need for people to be concerned.
Cutting a long story short, this is about anthrax and the invasion of anthrax into England, where people are stocking up duty freestyle and bringing a couple of litres of the gear over from Saddam's bottled low in Baghdad.
It's actually a drive-through. It's a drive-through. I'll slap a VB and some anthrax, mate. Yeah, nice.
Originally, these, I was going to say gastric juices of the most evil kind were going to be delivered by Scud Rocket. The Scud turns out to be a dud, and now it's basically up to well-meaning people going on a holiday in what used to be called the Far East to fill up and bring it back.
Is there a rest stop between you and the end of this story?
No, because I thought you might have something witty to say, and I wasn't going to let you do it.
Okay, Ashley, you are right. 3 points. Congratulations. Go on, ladies and gentlemen. British and Australian air and seaports are on alert after Saddam Hussein allegedly threatened to flood both countries with anthrax hidden in duty-free perfume, cosmetics, cigarette lighters, and alcohol. Saddam's anthrax has started something of a trend. Chanel is releasing botulism number 5. Revlon is working on Stay Fast Cholera, and Calvin Klein has come up with a new cologne called CKTB. But so what if Hussein puts anthrax in duty-free alcohol, lighters, perfume and cosmetics? I mean, who's going to die? Airline passengers who are drunk, smoking, smelly and ugly. Oasis.
Isn't it odd? We're worried about Iraq because they have weapons of mass destruction, unstable leader. All right, I'm from America. Weapons of mass destruction, unstable leader. You should be worried about us.
All right, let's do the scores, ladies and gentlemen. At this point in the show, the contagious McCrossins are sitting pretty on 8 points. While the contaminated Robinses have burst into the lead with 11 points. Okay, and before you know it, we're into the last round. Julie, Rich, Jennifer, your strange but true clues were the severed limb, the studded dog collar, and this fantastic suitcase.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, there have been some scarifying continuous allegations against your people from the United States.
No, this has nothing to do with me, not this one. No. I'm not taking the fall. This is an airport beagle who got a little overenthusiastic.
Your people have come up with a startling new approach to the protection of illicit drugs.
Of our drug
lords. It is your drug lords we're talking about. It isn't the...
Thank you.
It is your drug people who, in Florida, yes, used to protect their houses...
With pit bosses.
With pit bull.
Oh, yeah, pit bull.
Pit bull. You may be surprised how much publicity American pit bull terriers get in this country, but we understand they're vicious, and yet... The drug lords in the States, I understand, Jennifer, have come up with something even more terrifying than a pit bull terrier.
A severed leg.
They are... Yes.
No, let me guess. It's a crow.
Two words. Big word.
Severed jaws.
Jaws, yes.
Oscars. Oh, is it? Anything. Procol Harum, white a shade of pale.
Alligators in the swimming pools. They're putting alligators in their swimming pools.
Let's just walk around the pool. That's not saving anyone.
These would be alligators with a Yankee can do know-how, and they leap out of pools. If anyone goes near the drugs, whammo, they lose a leg. It's a tremendously good technique for protecting drugs if you want to protect the drug. And interestingly, ABC props have given us a little hint by giving us an alligator bag.
Ah.
We are calling upon you to award us massive points for extraordinary accuracy.
Accuracy, yes, but comedy, no. Rich, want to say anything?
I don't think it's very convincing. No. It smells... it smells the end of the poolside party.
You're right, alligators, yes. Thank you very much, Girl Wild. U.S. police say some criminal gangs have started using alligators, instead of pit bulls, to guard their supplies of cash and drugs. I'm surprised the alligator guard idea has gone ahead after the disastrous guide alligators for the blind affair. Yes, gators are good at guarding property, but at least when a German shepherd starts humping your leg, you don't have to stand there and take it. And it's easy to train an alligator to fetch a stick. You know, the hard part is getting them to let go of the pensioner using the stick. Mikey, Margaret HG, you are behoven to use the brain damage, the insurance policy, and that haunting tune.
For he's a jolly good fellow, for he's a jolly good fellow. Is that enough, Paul?
Too much, probably.
Right. Well, I actually think it's going to be the new snack of the Royal Easter Show, brain on a windshield.
It's like fairy floss.
No, Kerri-Ann Kennelly's is like fairy floss. This is actually an English story, my beloved colleagues.
I believe it's about an accident.
Yes. That would explain the windscreen wiping through the brain. Because you don't do that on purpose. It was an insurance broker.
It was an insurance investigator.
Claims assessor.
The funny thing about this was that instead of making him all kind of screwed up and miserable and unable to concentrate and all those things that normally happen, it made
him
happy.
When you get a windscreen one.
Yeah. It made him terrifically happy and cheerful.
To the point, Paul, where he couldn't perform his job. Thank you. Because his job was to go around and say, no, actually, when you...
Oh, I don't think so.
Definitely
not.
You
have
to have the leg bitten completely.
Oh, absolutely. No
cracks
bad
in the pool, no. As such, he was
unsuited.
Totally out of his depth.
Unsuited for his line of work.
And he was
retrenched.
Thank you.
Retrenched. At which point, no doubt, he claimed some insurance.
I just love you.
That's your answer. You're very happy. The car accident, bit of brain damage.
We can live with that.
Congratulations.
What we get?
Oh, I gave you 3.
Oh.
London insurance salesman Charles Cornell has been awarded $820,000 in damages after head injuries from a car accident gave him a nicer personality. And he was
well,
fired.
Well,
that's what we got.
Did you get his name?
What was the name of the alligator then, Paul?
Yes.
Yeah. Mr. Barky? Can you take someone's off?
Never again. Never again. McDermott from these lips. I had it.
Breakages. Since he lost his job, Charles has been avoided by everyone he knows in the insurance industry. So it hasn't been all bad. The funny thing is, the case has not actually set a precedent. An accident in a car left Madonna with a nicer personality, her daughter. Now, there have been a few incidents tonight which have made me sort of amend the scoring. Julie Macross and Rich Hall and Jennifer Byrne scored a subdural 11 points. However, because of Richard, you endured so many racial slurs.
Yes, I did.
Over the course
but
of the evening.
I hold nothing against these people.
Exactly,
people.
And now I'm going to give you 2 points for enduring those racial slurs. I'm also going to give you 2 points for your incredible, gregarious and generous nature over the course of the show and not striking HG. So that takes you under 15 points.
As a token of appreciation, I would like to present HG with his severed leg. And just to tell you, I hold nothing against you, but the Oscars are over, so you can lose the outfit now.
Mikey Robbins, Margaret Scott, and HG Nelson scored a Metzelbaum 14 points. However, I've taken 5 points off for Motormouth here, who couldn't shut up. Taken 3 points off for breakages, which takes you back to 6 points. So tonight, ladies and gentlemen, we give it to Julie Macross and Rich Hall and Jennifer Byrne. So we say, don't forget, Good News Week will be at the Melbourne Town Hall for the next few weeks as part of the International Melbourne Comedy Festival. Come down and see us. For now, we'd like to leave you with our own poetic tribute to the Princess of Wales. She travelled the world, her purpose to meet the victims of landmines no longer with feet. We'd still have our die, she'd be a survivor if one of the footless had been Dottie's driver. Good night.